Okay, here's today's cast of main characters. In the first half of the class, we'll hear primarily about the two most well-known English painters, Gainsborough and Reynolds, and we'll see many of the portraits they painted still on the walls of the houses whose owners are the subjects of these portraits. And then after the break, we'll be off to Salzburg in Vienna to hear about Mozart, and we'll also hear about Jean-Jacques Rousseau, who was one of the most influential authors of his age. This is a self-portrait now by Thomas Gainsborough, painted when he was 22. He was born in 1727 in Sudbury, northeast of London, and incidentally, that's just a few miles from the town of Hadley. His father was a fencing teacher, but his mother is described as a flower painter, so he may have inherited something from her, although artistic talent is much less likely to run in families than musical talent. Gainsborough is now usually regarded as a much more significant painter than Reynolds, but to their contemporaries, this was no issue for debate. Gainsborough was a fine painter, but Reynolds was the painter of the day, as well as an important enough writer, remember, as we've heard, to be the president of the literary club. I mentioned last time that there are more references to Reynolds in Boswell's biography of Johnson than to anyone but Johnson himself, and Gainsborough isn't mentioned even once. This is a landscape called Cornered Wood, painted by Gainsborough when he was just 21. He was briefly apprenticed, as Hogarth had been, to a silversmith in London, but he was, as all great artists really are, essentially self-taught. He once wrote to a friend that his school was the streets of London. However, he was often to say that what he really liked doing best was landscape painting like this, and I think perhaps the artist he may have admired the most was Jacob van Ruysdael, the great 17th century Dutch landscapist. Gainsborough once boasted that he had painted every tree in Suffolk, and from the looks of this, every leaf on every tree as well. This could pretty well pass for a Ruysdael, and the landscape backgrounds of many of Gainsborough's portraits will show Ruysdael's influence. Gainsborough's portraits will also remind you certainly of Van Dyck, who so well understood how the English liked to see themselves, but he was not, Gainsborough, influenced in any obvious way by the earthy subject matter of Hogarth, his own older contemporary. This is another self-portrait by Gainsborough now, in which he appears with his wife and his older daughter, Margaret. He was married at 19 to a girl named Margaret Burr, who is thought by many of his biographers to have been the illegitimate daughter of the 4th Duke of Bedford. The Britannica says this is likely, and I figure the Britannica doesn't print anything that's just gossip. She received an annuity from the Duke. He bought 20 of her husband's pictures. And when the Gainsboroughs moved to Bath, they lived right next door to him, all of which is certainly at least consistent with the illegitimate daughter theory. The Gainsborough family members were all a bit eccentric. His wife was neurotic about money, his younger daughter was insane and thought she was the rightful Queen of England, and his brother killed himself trying to fly. In 1748, when Gainsborough was 21, the family moved from Sudbury to Ipswich, which had a large population of wealthy potential portrait subjects and was something of a resort for vacationing squires and aristocrats. This double portrait of Robert Andrews and his wife is one of the first pictures he painted there. Like many of his portraits, it was kept in the subject's family for a long time, but it was finally sold to the London National Gallery in 1960 for $750,000. The Earl of Chesterfield made a famous comment on the painting, saying, and this is a bit of a paraphrase, that the subjects looked like they were paid to pose and weren't sure they were going to get their money. And they do certainly look like English smugness personified, But there is also a romantic touch to the picture in the informality of the pose in the outdoor setting, sort of as though they might have been posing for an 18th century edition of an L.L. Bean catalog. The picture is twice as wide as it is high, and the right half here is devoted completely to landscape, as you see, as though Gainsborough still hadn't quite given up the idea of painting English land rather than English faces for a living. Reynolds later remarked pointedly that Gainsborough was the greatest landscape painter in England. This is a portrait now of William Wollaston by Gainsborough, and it's still in Ipswich in the Christchurch Mansion. Wollaston represented Ipswich in the House of Commons and was an amateur musician, as was Gainsborough himself, whose favorite instrument was the cello. He also painted a portrait of Carl Friedrich Abel, the German composer who was popular in England. Mozart visited England, of course, during Gainsborough's career, and you're hearing Mozart's Flute Concerto K313 on a 250-year-old flute with other period instruments right now. And he painted Johann Christian Bach, the youngest of old Johann Sebastian's sons to survive him, and by whom we heard a Sinfonia Concertante last time. Gainsborough first met Bach, who's also known as the London Bach or the English Bach, at Bath, and often joined him in recreational music making. The Gainsboroughs moved from Ipswich to Bath, a still more affluent resort of the wealthy, in 1759, and Gainsborough was soon recognized as the man by whom the fashionable should be painted there. In 1762, he painted this portrait of William Poyntz, who specified that his dog should be included because he had chased a burglar out of his house. This picture is in the Spencer home at Althorpe, which we'll hear more about later. Poyntz was George John Spencer's brother-in-law, and we'll see George John's picture by Reynolds in a while. This picture, also painted at Bath, was the first one by Gainsborough to be commented upon by the London press and was exhibited there by the London Society of Artists, the predecessor of the Royal Academy, which was founded in 1768 under the patronage of George III. The most famous of all Gainsborough's Bath portraits is the one known as the Blue Boy here, which he painted in 1770. It was bought by Henry Huntington in 1921 from the Duke of Westminster for £148,000. That was a fabulous amount then, and is now in the Huntington Gallery in the Huntington Library Complex in L.A. This is a good example of how clothes and setting can make the man. This fellow, whose name was Jonathan Buttall, was the son of a man sometimes described as a blacksmith or ironmonger, though a wealthy one. But the boy looks like the Prince of Wales. It's often pointed out that the costume he's depicted wearing is 100 years out of date. This is the style of the 17th century, and it's as though Gainsborough were making a particular effort to make the guy look like a subject painted by Van Dyck. It's also often said that Gainsborough painted him in blue to contradict a supposed claim by Reynolds that one could not paint a successful portrait in blue. It's doubtful that Reynolds ever said that. He certainly painted subjects in blue himself. And likewise doubtful that Gainsborough intended any affront to Reynolds. There was no real rivalry between them, and there was plenty of work for both. Reynolds was much more self-promoting, and Gainsborough seems to have been content to let him rule the art world of their day, maybe in the confidence that it would eventually be his work which would be appreciated more by posterity. Portrait subjects are, of course, rarely doing anything, but often in Gainsborough's work it seems that they must never do anything. And the Blue Boy certainly has this air about him. It seems as though anything like ordinary life would have been completely foreign to him. He's the dilettante become a hero. John Ruskin said that Gainsborough's people are divinely doing nothing. Soon after such successes as these, Gainsborough moved in 1774 to London and into a mansion at No. 80 Pall Mall, or Pall Mall as the English call it, where the blue disc marks the spot. As far as the London portrait business was concerned, Reynolds had quite a head start on him, having been in the city for some 20 years by the time Gainsborough arrived. But as I suggested, there was no lack of subjects to go around, and you don't need to feel sorry for a painter who could afford to live at one of the best addresses in the city, just a stone's throw from Buckingham Palace. Gainsborough is usually considered to have had a bit of the bohemian about him. He drank a lot and tended to spend too much money to the frustration of his tight-fisted wife, but you couldn't be very bohemian and live here. By this time, Reynolds had been made the president of the newly established Royal Academy and had been knighted by the king. Gainsborough was a member of the Academy, but he never attended its meetings and never heard and probably never read any of Reynolds' famous discourses. This is Gainsborough's portrait of Elizabeth Ann Linley Sheridan, one of the most interesting London women of the era. Her father and her brother, both named Thomas, were important composers, and she was considered among the finest singers of her day. You're hearing a song by her father now. She was also the wife of the playwright Richard Brinsley Sheridan. She had been betrothed to one Major Matthews, but then eloped with Sheridan. And this resulted in a duel between Matthews and Sheridan, which was won by the latter, who had his rival at sword's point but spared his life. Matthews wouldn't give up, however, and a second duel ended in a muddy wrestling match that led Sheridan's father to disown him. Undaunted by this, he told his father he didn't care. He'd make a living as a writer. A lot of men have, of course, tried that approach, but Sheridan succeeded, maybe sufficiently motivated by such a beauty as this. Sadly, she died of tuberculosis at just 38, though. The picture's now in the Washington National Gallery. This is Gainsborough's portrait of Mary Cathcart Grimm, Lady Lindock, painted when she was just 19. Somewhere Goldsmith says that a beautiful woman decked out in all her finery is the most tremendous object in all creation. And Durant says that the clothes in Gainsborough's pictures would make Venus herself want to get dressed. Mary Cathcart here married the Scottish nobleman Thomas Grimm, Lord Lindock, and when she became ill some 15 years after the picture was painted, apparently with tuberculosis, they took a trip to the south of France, where it was hoped that the climate would improve her health. Unfortunately, she died, though, and as her husband was attempting to bring the body back through Paris, he was suspected by the revolutionaries, by then in charge, of smuggling contraband in the coffin, and the body was dumped out in the street. This so infuriated him that he vowed eternal vengeance on the French and pretty well got it. He was with Nelson in the attack on Toulon against the young artillery officer Napoleon Bonaparte. He was with the army that occupied Egypt after the ouster of France there. He was with John Moore in the Peninsular Campaign. And he was the first English soldier to set foot in France after the Battle of Vittoria in 1813. After the war, Baron Lindock played in the first cricket match ever staged in Scotland. He won a prize for horsemanship when he was over 80 and still hunted regularly until he died at 95. He walled up the portrait of his wife after his return from France, though, and never looked at it again. The Edinburgh National Gallery acquired it after his death. This is Gainsborough's portrait of Mary Robinson, known as Perdita, from the name of a character she was famous for playing in a popular drama of the day. She was also one of the many mistresses of the Prince Regent, the future George IV. There's a picture of him in the ring she's wearing. Either George III gave her £100,000 to go to France and not distract his son anymore, or else the prince himself gave her the money not to publish his love letters, or some combination of the two, depending on which sources you read. In any case, she then wrote a play about the prince himself called Nobody. It was only staged once. The prince's friends and foes came armed with stuff to throw at each other and the actors, and Perdita's career as a playwright ended in one night. She did write a lot of poetry also, however, and her name does sometimes come up in discussions of female writers of the age. After her affair with the prince was over, she also had another famous one with Sir Bannister Tarleton, whose portrait by Reynolds is in the London National Gallery, and then she too died young at just 42. When fate cares all. Here's a portrait by Gainsborough of a more significant theatrical figure, Mrs. Sarah Siddons, who was regarded as the finest serious actress of her day, the female equivalent to David Garrick. Some art historians argue that there's all the difference in the world between Reynolds and Gainsborough, but for most of us, it is often hard to tell who did what. In general, Reynolds' subjects are usually made to look more majestic, if not pompous, and Gainsborough's to look less so, but that kind of thing is hard to quantify. We'll see Reynolds' portrait of Mrs. Siddons here in a few minutes, and in his portrait, she will look like a kind of quasi-divinity, the tragic muse. Gainsborough's Mrs. Siddons here looks more like a prosperous aristocrat. In any case, she doesn't look like a woman born in a place called the Mutton Chop Tavern in Wales. She came a long way from there to the London stage and the studios of Gainsborough and Reynolds. And Gainsborough made a famous comment while working on this picture. He suddenly threw down his brush and exclaimed, "Your nose, madam, damn your nose, there's no end to it." Here's another subject painted by both Gainsborough and Reynolds, Captain John A. St. Leger, who looks more like a fashion model than a soldier, and I'm not sure he was ever on a battlefield in his life. And this is Gainsborough's portrait of his own daughter Mary, the one who was mad, although there's no suggestion of that in the picture. This is now a self-portrait by Joshua Reynolds, and one could argue from this that Reynolds did take himself more seriously than Gainsborough. It looks like he's trying to suggest a resemblance to Rembrandt, and the inclusion of the classical bust also adds a touch of the pretentious. It's also typical for Reynolds, as he does here, to make it seem as though we are looking up at his subject. John Kennedy calls him a terrible man and an inflated mediocrity as a painter, but Quentin Bell says, on the other hand, that he had none of the bad qualities that often go with genius and was hardly less great as a psychologist than Rembrandt himself. If he was as bad as Kennedy says, he certainly fooled Johnson and Boswell, who admired him a lot, as well as just about everybody else in the late 18th century in England. Like Gainsborough, he was from a middle-class background and went through the usual apprenticeship. And then when his father died, he went to live with his two unmarried sisters in Plymouth, where he began his professional career doing portraits of naval officers. Music. This is Reynolds' portrait of Admiral Augustus Keppel, who was the younger son of a nobleman, which meant that he got no part of the estate of his father. He went to sea at 10 as a cabin boy and went around the world at 15. He was the captain of the Victory before Nelson and eventually became a Viscount in his own right, ending his naval career as First Lord of the Admiralty. His sister married the son of the 4th Duke of Bedford, and in a bit we'll see her in a portrait by Reynolds, which is still in the Bedford home at Woburn Abbey. When Keppel sailed to the Mediterranean in 1750, he invited Reynolds to go along, and this gave him an opportunity to study both classical and Renaissance art, by which he was very much impressed, and he returned home feeling that he was the heir to the great traditions of Italy, and that his profession of artist was as high and mighty a calling as any. And the English pretty much agreed with him. After the success of this picture, he moved to London in 1753 and began his career in earnest. Before you forget what Gainsborough's portrait of Sarah Siddons looked like, this is Reynolds' version, and as I said, she looks now like a queen or a goddess on a throne, or maybe like one of Michelangelo's prophets on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel that Reynolds had noticed. She certainly doesn't look just like any other bourgeoise who could afford to shop at Harrods. Durant says that Johnson wrote his name on the hem of her robe, but it was apparently Reynolds himself who did that in the picture. Johnson had been dead for 5 years when the portrait was painted. The picture isn't in good shape, and I've never been able to make out any name on the hem at all. Reynolds experimented with all sorts of media, and a lot of his pictures, including this one, now look as though they were painted in places, at least, with something not much different than asphalt or tar. This now is Reynolds' portrait of John A. St. Leger, whose portrait by Gainsborough we also saw earlier. There's not as much obviously different about the approach Reynolds took here, but we are looking up at him now, and the isolation of the figure without the horse makes him look more monumental, I guess. He actually reminds me a bit of Gainsborough's Blue Boy in the way he's presented. Last quarter, we saw how Velazquez and Rubens and other Baroque painters of the 17th century exploited the way weather could affect the character of a picture and how a stormy or at least cloudy sky could make a hero look more heroic than he would on a bright sunny day. But in the work of Gainsborough and Reynolds, the overcast doesn't seem to have quite the same effect. At least, not always anyway. The mood created is often more poetic and romantic, rather than stern and somber, as though one would expect to hear flutes rather than trumpets. Again by Reynolds, here's a more manly looking fellow now, Lord Heathfield, who held Gibraltar during the American Revolution for 4 years against Franco-Spanish attempts to take it. And the sky behind him is practically black, as though filled with the smoke of battle, and the result is more Velazquez-like. On the other hand, this is his portrait of Miss Frances Crewe against a pastel-tinted, if nevertheless cloudy, sky more appropriate to the charm of the cutest portrait subject painted in the whole 18th century, I think. Gainsborough was thought to be the better painter of women, Reynolds of men, but this shows Reynolds could paint a portrait of any sort of subject. It should also be noticed that the dominant color here is blue, which has to make one question whether Reynolds ever said a successful portrait couldn't be painted using that color. Here's his portrait of Nellie O'Brien. She's described as a courtesan, but no courtesan ever looked less like one. I mentioned earlier that Reynolds was the president of the literary club, which included a lot of people who are certainly now thought to be more important writers than he was, people like Johnson and Boswell and Sheridan and Gibbon. But his annual addresses to the Royal Academy, which were printed, and his other writings on aesthetics were highly regarded by his contemporaries, and he does say a lot of interesting things. He says, for example, that genius can't be taught by rules, that it is born, not made, and I think he's right about this. But he also emphasizes very much the value of exposure to the great works of the past. If true skill in beauty and its representation are to be attained, and he takes it for granted that beauty in the grand style is the goal of all great art. And these are positions which I think should be regarded as more controversial. I don't think he ever mentions Hogarth's work, but it's clear that apart from the portraits, he wouldn't have liked it. He never married. He became fabulously wealthy, drove around London in a carriage with gold-plated wheels, and lived in a mansion on Leicester Square at this address, which significantly has a Ferrari parked in front of it. He left an estate of £150,000 to his nieces, having painted hundreds of portraits at £200 or £300 each, and some for as much as £1,000, this at a time when an income of £50 a year was considered good. This is another self-portrait by him as an older man. After Alan Ramsay died, he was made painter to the king, but it had always irritated him that George III preferred the lightweight Ramsay to himself, and none of Reynolds' best pictures are thought to have been done for the royal family. About 50 miles north of London is Althorpe, or Althorp as the English call it, which has been the home of the Spencer family for some 16 generations, and there are more pictures by Reynolds here than any place outside a museum. We heard about one famous member of the family earlier this quarter, Robert Spencer, Earl of Sunderland, whose son married Marlborough's daughter and whose great-grandson became the first Earl Spencer. Lady Diana Spencer, the late Princess of Wales, was the daughter of the 8th Earl. And while we see some more of Althorp, here we're going to listen to a song by Thomas Linley the Elder again, who was the father of Sheridan's wife, Elizabeth Ann Linley, whose portrait by Gainsborough we saw earlier, and this is a detail from it. She often sang it, so you can imagine she's going to sing it now. It's called Fly to My Aid, O Mighty Love.
Fly to my aid, O mighty love, from earth my heaven and my boss, with beauty lives and pleasure lives, to crown with bliss thy happy arms, to crown with bliss,
to crown with bliss thy happy arms.
Fly to my aid, O mighty love, from earth my heaven.
The graces bring
soft hearts thy body employs.
This is the Marlboro Room now at Althorp, which has been turned into a dining room since this picture was taken. The large picture is Reynolds' portrait of George John, 2nd Earl Spencer, one of the most important and interesting members of the family. He was in the literary club with Johnson and Boswell and all the other fellows I mentioned. He became ambassador to Vienna during the French Revolution. He was First Lord of the Admiralty. He was a good friend of Nelson's until the latter began his famous affair with Emma Hamilton. His wife Lavinia is in the portrait by Reynolds over the fireplace. And here's Lavinia up closer now. And in this part of the room, you can see Gainsborough's portrait of George John's sister, Georgiana, over the fireplace, who will become the famous 5th Duchess of Devonshire, one of the most celebrated personalities of her day, and the subject of a recent best-selling biography by Amanda Foreman. And the whole family was also the subject of another recent interesting book of popular biography called The Serpent and the Stag. And here at Chatsworth, you can see her now grown up with her own daughter, naturally named Georgiana, and again painted by Reynolds in one of his liveliest portraits. The Duchess of Devonshire here lived for years in a scandalous sort of ménage à trois of some sort with her husband and a woman named Elizabeth Foster, who was widely regarded as a gold digger, but was apparently regarded by Georgiana as at least a good friend even after she'd become the Duke's mistress. This is another portrait of Georgiana by Gainsborough. Elizabeth Ann Linley, whose portrait by Gainsborough we just saw earlier, and whom in effect we're still hearing sing her father's song, made a memorable comment on Georgiana. She said that whenever she entered a room, it seemed like there was too much of her. She also wrote poetry, which Horace Walpole said was prettily expressed, although it didn't express much. She was much addicted, too, to gambling, traded kisses for votes for her favorites, had at least one extramarital affair of her own, and on the whole was about as interesting a woman to read about as the 18th century produced. This is Reynolds' portrait now of Elizabeth Foster, Georgiana's at least sometime friend
and her successor as wife to the Duke of Devonshire.
After the Duke himself died, she moved to Rome and became involved in an affair with the Pope's Secretary of State, Cardinal Consalvi. And she died there but was buried at Chatsworth next to the Duke and Georgiana. This is Reynolds' portrait of George Spencer, 4th Duke of Marlborough, and his family at Blenheim. It's the largest portrait Reynolds ever painted, and he was paid £1,000 for it. The 4th Duke of Marlborough here was the second cousin once removed of George John, 2nd Earl Spencer of Althorp. Here's the picture up closer now. And the 4th Duke of Marlborough's wife, Carolyn, the center of the group, was the daughter of John Russell, the 4th Duke of Bedford, and thereby probably Gainsborough's sister-in-law, since, as I mentioned earlier, Gainsborough's wife was almost certainly the 4th Duke of Bedford's illegitimate daughter. The Russell family was very wealthy. Johnson, in fact, liked to use the phrase, as rich as Bedford, the way we might say as rich as Rockefeller, and they once owned a good part of London in the area of Bloomsbury and where the British Museum is now. Russell Square, which you see here, was once occupied by their London home. and streets like Bedford Place here looking toward Bloomsbury Square and Woburn Place and Bedford Way and Woburn Square and Great Russell Street and Tavistock Square and Tavistock Place
all commemorate the family's former holdings.
And this is Woburn Abbey itself now, just about 25 miles north of London, and it's been the country home of the Russells since the mid-18th century, when it was built by the architect John Flitcroft. There was an earlier residence here, which had been built after the family acquired the property at the dissolution of the monasteries under Henry VIII in the 1530s, but nothing of that building survives. In 1960, the 12th Duke died at just 40 in an auto accident, and if you don't give your property to your heir more than 7 years before your death, the tax bill he has to pay goes up astronomically. And since the 40-year-old 12th Duke had probably expected to live more than 7 years longer, he'd given nothing to his son, who was then faced with a whopping $20 million tax assessment. He was able, however, to sell enough property, paintings, and so on to pay the bill. Like many other stately homes, Woburn is operated today like a kind of theme park so that enough money can be brought in to allow the family to keep it, and the 13th Duke has already given it to his son and moved off to live in the Bahamas. Inside now, in the blue room, the wallpaper of which has faded a lot in 250 years, you can see Gainsborough's portrait of his apparent father-in-law, the 4th Duke of Bedford, with his wife Gertrude on the right and his daughter Carolyn, whom we saw at Blenheim, on the left. There have been a lot of famous Russells since his day, but probably the most well-known is the philosopher Bertrand Russell, 3rd Earl Russell, who is his great-grandson. Here are two of Gainsborough's early landscapes, and as I mentioned, the fact that the Duke bought some 20 pictures by Gainsborough, including several when he was still an unknown, struggling artist, does suggest he was making sure his unacknowledged daughter was getting enough to eat. This is called the Breakfast Room, and on the right is a portrait by Reynolds of the wife of the Marquis of Tavistock, the Duke's son. She was the sister of Augustus Keppel, whose portrait by Reynolds we saw a while ago. Unfortunately, he died as the result of a riding accident just 2 years after they were married, and then she fell into a depression, refused to eat, and died herself just a year later. She's depicted here before the marriage wearing the dress she wore at the wedding of George III to Charlotte of Mecklenburg. This is the long gallery at Woburn. The overall style of decoration here is called Georgian or sometimes neoclassicism. I think the best examples of this style are perhaps to be found at Harwood, the home of the Lassells family in Yorkshire, and at Fairfax House in York. The former is the work of Robert Adam, the most important English architect after Wren in the 18th century, and his pupil John Carr.
We'll take a short tour of Harwood now while we hear part of the first movement of Haydn's Symphony No. 96. It's one of the symphonies which he wrote while he was in England. This is called the Cinnamon Drawing Room, and at the left are portraits by Reynolds of Edward Lassells and of his son to the right, Edward, 1st Earl of Harwood, who built the place. Here's the latter's stepsister, Lady Worsley, on the wall opposite, also by Reynolds. This is called Princess Mary's Room. The desk in the center and the commode at the right are considered among the finest things ever made by Thomas Chippendale. Room with Mrs. Hale, the first Earl's sister-in-law, at the right by Reynolds. The so-called Spanish Library. Hiding himself now by the Englishman John Hoppner. And this is Salzburg now, and after the break, we'll be off to hear about Mozart.